The X-Men Dark Phoenix movie has come out, but aren't you curious what happened in the actual comic book? Because I haven't even seen the movie yet, and I can tell you it's not going to be accurate. So today we're going to cover the Dark Phoenix storyline, the original one. Now, this is an old storyline from the 80s, so we're kind of jumping ahead to just the actual Dark Phoenix portion of it. So, at this point, we've already had Phoenix, we've already had a bunch of things happening, we've already had the Dark Phoenix come back, but we are about to jump into that. And if you're wondering where you are, well, you have found the Comic Story Channel. We bring you audio dramas, catching you up on the lore to your favorite comic books, movies, and video games. And today, we're covering Dark Phoenix. Let's go ahead and get into that.
Before we can begin the Dark Phoenix, we need to let you know how we got here. So here's a quick recap catching you up. It was several months ago that Jean Grey, a young mutant and member of the X-Men, was exposed to deadly solar radiation while in space. However, instead of truly killing her, it allowed her to reach the peak of her powers, resurrecting her once more on Earth. And she dubbed herself the Phoenix and joined the X-Men. Knowing that such power can be dangerous, however, mental blockers were put into place so that she may not danger those around her. Yet all was not well. Jean and the rest of the team suddenly found themselves at odds with the secretive Hellfire Club. Over several months, the mutant known as Mastermind, working with the Hellfire Club, began to manipulate Jean into believing that she was one of her ancestors from the 1700s, a woman that was a part of the Hellfire Club. Unknown to Jean, though, with every flash that she has into the supposed past, another one of the mental blockers that was put into place to hold back her power falls away. The team first came into contact with the club's agents when they were sent by their mentor, Professor Xavier, to meet a young mutant named Kitty Pryde. When half the team was captured, Kitty manages to gain some control over her new powers and escape, calling in the rest of the team from their meeting with Dazzler. After Jean manages to defeat the Hellfire Club psychic, the White Queen, the team escapes and Kitty is returned to her family safely. Realizing that they have a new enemy, the team then works with Warren Worthington, also known as Angel, to sneak inside of the New York-based Hellfire Club. Unfortunately, Sebastian Shaw was ready for them and the team is quickly incapacitated, with Jean now fully believing that she is a member of the club known as the Black Queen. Believing that the woman that he loves is still inside of her, Scott Summers tried to reason with Jean. But it was only by using the psychic link that they share that he was able to go inside of her mind and fight the psychic version of Mastermind that has been manipulating her. With the death of this mental projection, Jean is freed from the control of the Hellfire Club and the team begins their escape. However, with the last shred of Mastermind gone, so are the final blockers that kept Jean from accessing her true power. Waiting for Mastermind in the shadows, Jean can feel the change coming over her. The power of the Phoenix is truly great, and it consumes her. Seeing the man that tormented her for months, she unleashes that power onto him, cursing him for the forces that he has set into motion. Instead of killing him, though, she uses the power of the Phoenix to expand his mind, to show him things that no living being has ever known. His mind is in touch with all of reality at once, and unable to cope, he snaps. Jean can feel the Phoenix burning within her soul, spreading its wings, soaring towards a destiny that cannot be denied. Fleeing the building, the X-Men make their way to Central Park, where Cyclops calls to a skycraft to come and pick them up. The team quickly boards and they take off. Jean is still reeling from the whole ordeal, though, from the power and the feelings that are overwhelming her body. Wolverine leans out, staring at the police that have arrived at the Hellfire Club, no doubt looking for them.
We ought to be flattered. Looks like they've rounded up an army for us.
Against an army, Wolverine, you would have at least stood a chance for survival. Against me, you have none. The voice calls out from behind them, and that voice, it's Jean Grey, yet it's not. The team turns, shock filling their faces as the craft begins to fill with fire. Heal me, X-Men! No longer am I the woman that you knew. I am fire. I am life incarnate. I am the Dark Phoenix. With these words, the ship explodes into a fireball, almost disintegrating around them. The team begins to fall through the sky, plummeting to the earth below, with Colossus slamming into the ground hard, knowing that a fall from this height won't hurt him. Nightcrawler bants as the stench of brimstone fills the air, and he rolls onto the ground below, yet his speed still too fast, and he hurls himself into the bushes. Storm calls upon the winds and lightning to confuse the Dark Phoenix as she swoops in, catching Wolverine and Cyclops. Reaching the ground, though, they discover that their respite is a brief one. Yours was an admirable ploy, Storm. But escaping me won't be that easy. Phoenix cries, pushing through the rain, the wind, and the lightning. The team stands ready as the Dark Phoenix attacks. Whatever is left of Jean Grey is enjoying this use of her powers. Colossus turns, ripping a tree out of the ground to use as a weapon, yet Phoenix merely waves her hand, and he transforms back into his human self, without the strength to lift the tree. Wolverine moves in to help, yet another wave, and the tree is solid gold, falling on the pair and pinning them to the ground. Storm once again moves in, trying to reason with her friend, yet there is very little of Jean left, and in a matter of seconds, the rest of the X-Men are on the ground. The battle is over. She stands over her fallen enemies. She is done with the X-Men. My destiny is in the stars! She cries as the Phoenix forces curl around her, forming a great fiery bird that burns bright enough for the entirety of New York to see. It is over in the Baxter Building that Reed Richards picks up the power signature on his equipment. Elsewhere, Spider-Man turns to see the vast power looming over Central Park. In deep space, the Silver Surfer can sense a kindred spirit of cosmic powers, and he turns his board towards Earth. Yet the Dark Phoenix cares not for these things and lifts upwards into space, bidding her home planet goodbye. Ecstasy fills her face as the power surrounds her and she flies into the cosmos. She has no limits, and with incredible speed, she flies towards the sun, looping around it, skimming its surface. This boosts her speed even further, and in a matter of seconds, she is passing the planet of Jupiter. And seconds after that, she is passing through the whole solar system, her powers flaring again, creating a stargate for her. Her powers pass her through time and space, and she is suddenly hurled from the Milky Way, appearing once more in a galaxy far away. The Dark Phoenix suddenly realizes that this journey has taken more from her than she thought, and she goes ravenous in her hunger. The center of this strange solar system lays before her, and without hesitation, she flies directly into it. This star will do nicely, she thinks to herself. Without the thought of the consequences, the Dark Phoenix dives into the heart of the star. Should it be left alone, the star would most likely live for another 6 billion years. Yet now, with the Dark Phoenix in need, it will only last a few more minutes. And in the system of 11 planets that is currently orbiting this star, the fourth one is inhabited by ancient, peace-loving people. On the dayside, the citizens of this world look up at the flaring of light that fills the sky. It's beautiful in its own way, yet it fills these people with the fear of the unknown. It matters not, though, that they are dead within seconds. The heat flare boils the planet with a shockwave obliterating all that stands in its way. Most of those on the nightside are lucky, though, in that they pass in their sleep, unaware of the total destruction of their world. At the center of the star, the Dark Phoenix thrills at the power that she feels, as it fills her with pure ecstasy. And on the fringes of the solar system, the Shi'ar battlecruiser floats. Give me tactical! The captain orders as their sensors pick up the flare of the dying star. None of the bridge officers can explain what happened. None of their readings make any sense. The star was perfectly healthy during this morning's scans. It should not have occurred, the science officer concludes. Suddenly, the bridge crew is shocked by what appears on their screens. From the fiery destruction, a single form can be seen flying away. It appears to be humanoid. What kind of creature is it? The captain questions before turning to his crew, determination on his face. Sound the battle stations! We will engage, he orders. The battlecruiser opens fire, yet the Dark Phoenix is easily able to dodge. She turns, anger filling her features in the vast coldness of space. And with a flare of power, she lashes through the battlecruiser, disabling it in a mere seconds. Realizing that the doom is upon them, the captain orders a message to be sent to the Shi'ar homeworld. On the ancient world, seat of the Shi'ar Empire, the Queen Lilandra is awakened. The situation is quickly explained to her as she dashes to the command center. The vision screens show the bridge of the battlecruiser and the fiery bird that lashed out against it. Lilandra, can you see it? The captain cries, and the bridge crew take each other's hands as their doom finds them, and the screens they go black. Technician, regain contact! The queen orders, yet he cannot, for there is nothing there. Meanwhile, back on Earth, the X-Men are trying to get over their defeat at the hands of their former friend. No one is taking this as hard as Cyclops. Suddenly, Cyclops bolts upright at a table, startling the rest of the team. Scott, what's wrong? Nightcrawler questions, with fear filling Scott's voice. It's Phoenix. I could sense her in my mind. She's returning to Earth and she's hungry. Meanwhile, in deep space, Lilandra is calling out to the others to gather various ministers in the Shi'ar Empire. The meeting views the events of the Phoenix destroying the entire solar system and wiping out a Shi'ar battlecruiser with very little effort. Lilandra knows that the Phoenix resides within Jean Grey, a benevolent young girl from Earth, who had previously saved the universe from Lilandra's own brother. Yet, she sees now that the Phoenix has overtaken Jean, and that now The entire galaxy is in danger. The universe is to survive. The Phoenix must be destroyed. Back on Earth, the X-Men are working endlessly. Hank McCoy, former X-Men and now a member of the Avengers, has pledged his aid. He continues to work on a device that should disrupt her powers and allow them a fighting chance against the Dark Phoenix. Meanwhile, knowing that they are the smart ones, Wolverine, Colossus, and Nightcrawler are honing their skills in the Danger Room, hoping that the physical exertion will take their minds off their defeat at the hands of Jean earlier and what they may have to do to stomp her. A short time ago, Jean Grey was sailing through the cosmos as the Dark Phoenix, with creation itself trembling at her passing. And now, she lands in the yard of her childhood home, a house on Annadale Road, where Jean Grey grew up. She stands in the front yard, the night dark and quiet around her, and finally she moves forward, pushing into the house. It's the inside that she remembers, the look of the place, the smell. Yet now they seem like someone else's memories, someone else's experiences. Jean Grey was a gentle and loving person who would sacrifice herself to save others. The Dark Phoenix is the destroyer of worlds. Suddenly the lights click on and Jean turns to see her father. Surprise and happiness fill this man's face as he steps forward, embracing his daughter. Her mother and sister then appear, questioning why she is here and how she has been. Yet the Dark Phoenix can read their thoughts and sense the true feelings in their hearts. They fear her. They fear what she is and what she has become. Anger begins to flare within her. What is wrong with what she has become? She is the Dark Phoenix, the power incarnate. She holds the very fate of the universe in her hands. She turns, interrupting their questions as her power flares. You fear me, all of you, and with good reason, she cries, demonstrating her power to alter molecules. Father steps forward, glaring at her. Who are you? What are you? You are no daughter of mine. I cast you out, he cries. Somewhere deep inside of the Dark Phoenix, Jean Grey is begging for her father to stop, but the powerful being suddenly turns and sees a strange fog enveloping the house through the windows. She flies outside knowing that this must be Storm's doing, yet she can sense her former teammates. Suddenly, the smell of brimstone fills the air with Nightcrawler on top of her. Surprise! I'm truly sorry that things must turn out this way. He apologizes as he slips the device that Hank has created to disrupt her powers around Jean's head. Pain rips through her as the device disrupts her mental powers, her body flexing, and Nightcrawler is thrown aside. She careens through the air but is quickly caught by Colossus. Do not fight us, Phoenix! The more you struggle, the more you will be in pain! He tries to reason with her, yet the Phoenix has more than just Jean's mental powers, and with a surprising show of strength, she whips the Metal Man through a boulder. Storm moves in, once again trying to hold Phoenix at bay with her power, yet energy crackles, throwing the Storm Witch aside. Beast manages to grab her, trying to hold her steady as Wolverine moves in. He knows what he has to do. Tackling her to the ground, he pins her with his claws popped, and he rears back. Forgive me, darling. He growls as the Phoenix's features soften, and Jean is looking back at him again. Do it, Wolverine. Strike while the human part of me is in control. Finish me. She struggles, tears filling her eyes. But the sight of Jean once more causes Logan to hesitate, and in that brief moment, the Phoenix once again rises, her powers flaring, Hank's device overloads, and the Dark Phoenix smiles wickedly as she rips it off her head. What a pity, Hank. I've overloaded your device. This was an admirable ploy, X-Men, but one that failed. She raises her hands, and the team is locked in place, and they begin to rise as the energy surrounds them. Stop it, Jean! Cyclops says from behind her. She turns, surprised. Yet he isn't there to kill her. He knows that she won't kill them. She loves them. The Dark Phoenix knows nothing of love. She growls, yet Scott knows that Jean's very existence springs from love. Briefly, the Phoenix hesitates. In that moment, Professor X strikes. She falls briefly, but quickly strikes back, her blast knocking them both back. The Dark Phoenix stands before Charles now, and he knows what he must do. The Phoenix flares again as the two are locked in a psychic battle. The struggle is epic as the two wage a war on a different plane of existence. The powers of the Phoenix flare brighter, lighting the countryside as if a small sun has appeared. Yet the end comes quickly and the light dims. And in the night, Jean Grey lays in the ground. Quickly, Scott is there, lifting his love. Hi, she smiles in his arms. Quickly, the two embrace as their thoughts of love fill each other's minds. The rest of the team arrives with Angel having brought Professor X to the fight. Her family comes out as well, glad to see their daughter is all right. Yet suddenly, there's a bright flash and the entire X-Men team is gone. Stunned, Jean's family stands there staring at the spot where the mutants had just stood, not knowing if they'll ever see their daughter again. The team look around, shock filling their faces. Moments ago, they were standing on the dark lawn in upstate New York, and now they stand in a large chamber surrounded by aliens. Behind them, the Gladiator and member of the Shi'ar Imperial Guard, steps forward.
X-Men, heed my words. You stand in the presence of Empress Lilandra. Your fates are in her hands.
His words echo through the chamber as the Empress steps out. Cyclops pulls Jean close, demanding to know what this is about. The X-Men were your friends. Why have you kidnapped us? He questions. And Lilandra nods, for she knows that they are her friends.
To ensure your safety and the safety of the universe, the Phoenix must be destroyed, she commands,
shock filling the X-Men as Gladiator explains what the Dark Phoenix did while she was loose in the galaxy. The fate of that lost solar system and the Shi'ar battlecruiser that tried to defend it.
The guards begin to close in, yet everyone pauses as Charles Xavier raises his hand.
For Jean Grey's life, I challenge you to a duel of honor,
he cries, though she glares inwardly. Lilandra is impressed with Charles's knowledge of their culture.
It is later, after discussing the issue with her allies, that the Empress returns. I accept your challenge, and I pray that you will not live to regret what you have done this day.
She informs him and offers them the day to rest, regain their strength, and prepare for the duel. That night, each X-Man takes his own personal time, dwelling on their own thoughts as to what it means to be an X-Man and to fight for their friends. Nightcrawler and Angel exercise together while Logan takes the night to meditate, knowing that he hesitated once and will do so again. Beast takes a bath and relaxes. Colossus sleeps the night away. Storm uses the night to think back on her past before the X-Men. Scott and Jean spend it together. At the dawn, the X-Men stand ready to fight what lays ahead. Quickly, they are teleported to the blue side of the moon. As the team vanishes, Lilandra watches the spot where they stood.
Suppose they win, the minister questions. Yet she stares determined.
They will not win. You have my word on that.
Down on the moon, the team quickly moves, and Scott orders everyone to start with hit and run tactics, for they don't have a lot of time. The team separates, trying to recon the area, and quickly, though, they are set upon by the Imperial Guard. Angel leaps into the sky, starting an aerial battle with the being known as Oracle. Meanwhile, the second team is attacked as well, and Colossus leaps to fight Warstar, and the X-Men are now fully engaged with the Imperial Guard. Storm tries to deal with several members, but is the first to fall at the hands of Hussar and her Necro Whip. The battle rages on, but the team is barely holding its own. Wolverine stalks through the battlefield as he stumbles across Storm, his teammates coming from behind him. Yet Logan quickly reacts, throwing the woman against the wall. Suddenly she transforms, becoming a shape-shifting Skrull. Claws pop and Logan attacks, but is thrown away by a Kree energy blast. Sneaking through the shadows, Nightcrawler tries to deal with Manta. Yet she deals with him in one blast and he falls from the fight. Beast is the next to fall as Colossus leaps to help his friend. He is attacked by Gladiator. The two powerhouses begin to trade blows, and with every impact, the buildings begin to shatter and fall around them. The structures collapse, and it is from the rubble that Gladiator emerges, pulling the fallen Russian. Once only Cyclops and Jean remain, the two begin to run, firing to keep the guard off their tail. Quickly, they hide in an alcove, with Jean covering the entrance to give them a moment of respite.
We got some breathing room, yet sooner or later, we have to come out,
she informs him. Scott knows, and he turns to his love.
So much I want to say. So much I feel. I don't have the words. He stumbles, trying to get it out.
Yet Jean knows, for she can read his thoughts. So, the two take each other's hands, and they step once more into the battle. The guards close in, and the fight rages on, yet from their vantage point, the Shi'ar suddenly sense a flare of energy. It is on that moon that the Dark Phoenix rises again, the fight unlocking that energy once again hidden within Jean. Cyclops stares, stunned, hearing the commands of Xavier in his mind to attack her while she is still weak. Optic beams fire, shattering the wall behind her, and the rest of the X-Men struggle awake as Xavier commands them. Storm uses her powers to whip around Jean, distracting her, and Wolverine uses the low gravity of the moon to hurl Colossus, allowing the Russian to crack her across the jaw. And in that brief moment of clarity, Jean once again begs her teammates to kill her, yet they can't. So she retreats, heading into the dark chamber. Cyclops following, trying to reason with her, yet she turns, using her powers to hold him in place.
I'm scared, Scott. I could feel the Dark Phoenix within me taking over, she explains.
She leans forward, taking his face in her hands. She killed an entire world. It's better this way. Quick, clean, final. I love you, Scott. He turns to the strange machine that sits in the center chamber, and it activates. Scott screams as he realizes what his love is about to do. That machine fires, and the light fills the chamber, blinding him, and he falls as the Phoenix's powers fade. And then where Jean once stood? Well, it's nothing but a blackened, charred patch of dirt. She planned this. She must have read the minds of the Imperial Guard and known this device was here. Cyclops crumbles to the ground of the chamber, tears falling from his eyes as a patch of earth that was his love smokes.
It's always interesting to see the original stories and how they play into how the movie was done. So let me know in the comments down below, do you feel that the original three-issue arc of Dark Phoenix is better than the movie? Or do you think the movie is better than the original three-issue arc? Either way, I hope you guys enjoyed this. If there was spoilers, well, I haven't seen the movie yet, so I don't know how close they got to the book. Either way, I hope you guys enjoyed, and I will see you next time right here at ComicStorian. And if you want more stuff like this, subscribe to the channel and find us over on Twitter @ComicStorian or Instagram @ ComicStorian.